Thank you for this nice introduction, and thank you, of course, for having me in this wonderful and venerable hall. It's my great pleasure to be here. As Rende just said, it's, I think, my third or fourth time on the workshop, and I really, really enjoyed this workshop every time I was here, and so this time as well. Yeah, Rende was, before actually starting, was just mocking me about the title of my talk, which is Platforms, Trust, and What May Come, and he said that it's a really, really defensive way of putting a title there. So it's kind of a disclaimer. So if any of the predictions I have in the presentation doesn't come true at some point, well, you have been warned. It may come. It still may not. Right. So, yeah, and as mentioned, a lot of my work recently has been about platforms, and you may have also noticed that the general notion of the sharing economy has somewhat, at least for some researchers in some fields, kind of shifted towards the platform economy or the gig economy as well. And so a lot of the research I do is about platforms and the economics of platforms as well. And I think it was Gerrit putting it neatly yesterday when he quoted, I think, a Twitter post, saying that for some reason we managed to come a really long way along the last 20 years from when it was really obligatory in the 90s not to let strangers into your cars, not to let strangers into your homes, and also not to get into strangers' cars or homes. And also it was really important not to meet people you just met online in the internet. Well, and here we are 15, 20 years later with Airbnb and BlaBlaCar, where you literally, the first thing you do in the morning is get online, hook up with strangers and get in their cars or let them into your home. So this is quite a remarkable shift of paradigms, I think, 180 degrees. And it will be interesting to see how we get there. We really didn't notice this shift because it happened so slowly and so steadily over the last 15, 20 years. And I think platforms in this regard play a really, really crucial role. So, and they do play a role, I think, not only as a technical facilitator of transactions, but also as a sort of social norm, where today platforms and companies like Uber, Airbnb, etc., set de facto standards for what is appropriate and how interactions between people online actually function. So, in order to get the terms straight, I want to just say a little bit about what I understand as a platform. And for me, at least in the scope of this talk, I will think of platforms as two-sided marketplaces, so as these technical facilitators of transactions, which enable large-scale transactions between these two market sides, usually consumers and providers in certain domains. And they are governed by network effects. And this comes along with a lot of intricacies in terms of pricing and in terms of launching platforms as well. So, and in order to locate the work we've been doing within this broader sharing economy umbrella term, we've been coming up with like a taxonomy in order to classify what we've been doing. And this is also my first recommendation for anyone that has research in this field, especially maybe for the younger scholars, but I also experienced this myself. It's really important to define the context and scope of your work. And this is a project with Florian Havlicek some time ago and Henner. And we tried to delineate what we were talking about in this project by means of taxonomy in this regard, where we thought of these two dimensions that platforms and sharing mechanisms can be classified. And the one would be the type of resource that is shared or that is handled on the platform. And this could be a pure product on the one hand, or it could be a pure service on the other hand. And in between, there's this mixed type of a product service where the product does play a vital role, but the product alone doesn't work as it stands. You need some service addition to it. And then we have the second dimension, which we looked at the degree of commerciality, saying that Well, there are professional or corporate providers that usually only do something if it's reimbursed, only if they can earn money with it. So this is the one extreme. And on the other hand, there are the private or the non-professional, the non-commercial providers, people like you and me that offer a ride, offer an apartment or spare products for sale. And this may be reimbursed as well. So people do this actually to earn money, but it may be free of charge as well. So, and this already comes up with this nice little matrix of possibilities, and looking at products, you can further distinguish between products that are actually sold, so where there is a transfer of ownership, and products that are simply rented out for a while and then return back to the owner. And this first of all allowed us to put like names and verbs to all these cells in this matrix, where we can now clearly differentiate between selling, renting, gifting, lending, co-usage and servicing, or even volunteering. And it also allowed us to put like the platform logos in there, which really helps in, I guess, for readers and also especially for reviewers to understand what we actually been talking about. And it gets tricky right away if you look at Airbnb, where do you put it, right? Because there are different sorts of transactions, sorts of interactions going on this platform already. So it at least spans in this area of product services that may be rented or that may be co-used, if you think of apartments that are rented completely or shared rooms within an apartment where you definitely expect some interaction with the host in this apartment, right? So these platforms kind of create a blurry picture here, but others can be allocated neatly, like Airbnb, where you sell products for money and the product experiences a change of ownership then. And on the other hand, you have platforms like TaskRabbit or Helpling, where it's about pure servicing, which is also denoted like the gig economy. And then, in order to better understand what platforms do, it's, in my opinion, quite helpful to compare them against the traditional pipeline business models that we experienced basically all over the 20th century, right? Where traditional pipeline firms would take in some raw materials, some products, and then produce something and distribute the final product to their customers, right? And so something goes in and something goes out. On the other hand, it's a linear pipeline model. And if you look at the core value-adding activities, they're about marketing, about assembling, about storage, all the classic activities that firms and companies have had to do. And the picture is a bit different, of course, for platforms, where this pipelining is broken up. And the production and the distribution side are somewhat outside the boundaries of the classical firm, right? Where the core value added measures of the platform company, of the platform firm, or as we even can say, the platform, now focuses on a smaller set of core value adding activities and only connects providers and consumers, which are basically outside of the platform. And well, the activities also change. We now have activities like coordination, sometimes even standardization. It's about community management. It's about managing payments, and all, especially about managing trust and reputation, because these people don't know each other beforehand. The providers may be non-professionals without a global established brand. So there's definitely a little bit more information asymmetry than in other markets. So platforms need to think about how to create trust in this environment. So this is how it looks. Providers provide raw products. And since it was so much work to create this animation, I'll just play it again. Something goes in. And if you notice, I play it once again. All the products that go to the consumers have the same shape, but a different color. Yeah? And then the money stream is also split between the platform and the providers. All right. And well, what has been a basic principle in logistics, that is just-in-time delivery, is in these models even taken a step further, where you now say it's not even mine, right? The products are not even the platform's products, but they're just managing. And this allows a whole different and a whole more efficient capital structure, of course, and much faster scaling, and all these advantages you know from platforms. So there will be a short exam in the next coffee break, and this is the relevant slide for this exam. Because platforms bring together these two market sides, it's important to know how or to look at how these interact upon each other. And in particular, each side benefits if there are more people from the other side, right? So providers on the platform benefit if there are more consumers and vice versa. And so it's quite expectable that the number of people that sign up for the platform will, among other things, also depend on the people or the number of users from the opposite market side, right? And this is like illustrated in this little chart here, where the blue and the red curve just represents this dependency for both market sides. And as you can see, there are intersection points, and this is where apparently equilibria are found. And there's an equilibrium in the zero point, right, where the market didn't work. There's one on the upper right side where we have actually something going on in the market, and we have this other critical equilibrium right there in the middle, which plays a really fundamental role as the critical mass that the platform needs to overcome in order to achieve success. And it becomes even more difficult or more tricky if you take in pricing into this consideration, right? Think of Uber, for instance, where Uber is setting prices, and these prices may change over time or even during one day. And depending on prices, you will expect a different curvature or different functions here. Assume that, okay, this is the dynamic. And now assume that, it's hard to read for me even, assume slightly, I think, lower prices. You will see that given the same number of suppliers, so the same value of the x-axis, on the x-axis, the blue curve has slightly moved to the top, right? So for slightly lower prices, there will be more demand, which is like one of the basic principles in economic. However, the red curve has slightly shifted to the left, which is the bottom from this perspective. So for lower prices and the exact same number of demanders on the platform, a slightly lower number of suppliers will be willing to sign up or to provide the product. So, and this also shifts the location of these equilibria. And the same holds if you change the price in the other direction, right? And what you can do now is to look at diagrams where you plot these viable equilibria, so the market clearing capacities against prices, right? And this is just done here. And as you can see, you get these kind of round shapes of viable prices and viable capacities in the market. And one thing to note is that there's not only an upper limit to the prices above which you can't really gain any new customers or users for the platform, but there's also a lower limit. And this is fundamentally different to basically every other sort of market where you always are able to decrease your price in order to gain further customers for your business. But it's not possible on these two-sided markets, because you have to take also into account that you have providers that need to earn money, and if the price decreases too much, it's just not worthwhile for them to sign up, and in turn then also not for the customers. All right, so I said this will be subject to a small test, and I guess you will be able to reproduce this. So thinking of platforms, and as I just said, it's important to think of factors like trust. We simply ask what actually creates trust on platforms, and what do platforms do in order to create trust? And this will structure the rest of my presentation now. Another aspect is this market reputation positivity bias we observe on basically every platform. Then I will talk a little bit about cross-platform reputation portability, where reputation may even flow between platforms. And then I will give some few remarks on some potential avenues for future work that I think may be really interesting for this entire community here. So looking at platforms like Airbnb, you see this whole palette of features that are used to build trust. And most of them won't be news to you. There are star ratings, there are text reviews, there's this identity verification, there are badges. There's other implicit information, there are profile images. And this is not only true for Airbnb, of course, this is basically true for every other platform you look at. And for most cases, you will observe most of these features for building trust and managing reputation. This is true for Wingly, for Turo, for eBay, and other platforms as well. Wingly, you may have heard about it, it's like a ride-sharing platform, but it's with small airplanes. So I guess in this regard, it's really important to trust your pilot in order to at least be capable of flying an airplane in a safe manner. So you see that the level of required trust may even vary between these platforms. And what we did after observing this in practice was to systematically crawl this set of platforms, in this case 11 platforms, and to look at these reputational and trust features and how which platform employs which feature and how these specifically score. And I guess it's a little bit hard to read, but what you see in the left, in the most left column here is that basically every of these platforms under consideration here employs some sort of reputation mechanism in terms of a star rating, and that the skewness, that is the skewness to the positive ratings is really high on many of these platforms. And it's reportedly really high on Airbnb, but Airbnb isn't the highest one. There are much more skewed ones like Airbnb, like eBay, where basically everyone has a 100% positive rating. And in one project, we attempted to follow up this observation and attempted to provide an additional explanation for this skewness. And you may be familiar with some of the explanations that stick around, that, for instance, negative experience do happen but are less frequently reported, or that based on the social interaction between people on the platform, they just are not willing to report negative experiences or reframe it in a positive way. And this may all hold, and in this approach, we kind of thought of a new way in which we thought, well, many different ratings may actually be provided on the platform, but based on the fact that the market is dynamic and listings and hosts drop out of the market frequently and new hosts are coming in, those listings, those hosts with negative reviews may have a higher probability of dropping out of the market. Right? This is reflected in the red, yellow, and green colors here, listings of different ratings. And at the beginning of this thought experiment, every rating is still equally present in the market. But after a while, since listings drop out, and the probability of dropping out is higher for lower rated listings, this picture changes. And this is then not due to a differentiated picture of how ratings are given, but only due to this market dynamic. And in order to assess this churn hypothesis, we drew on data based on Inside Airbnb, which is a really nice online repository of Airbnb listings, which is frequently updated and provides data for many, many cities around the world on a monthly basis. And we looked at Airbnb data, in this case for Berlin, over the course of 19 months, almost 2 years. And what we see here is that, well, overall, the number of listings in the city increased in that period, and we also observed a really high turnover rate of about 7% per month. So, like every month, 7% of all listings dropped out, and another a little bit more than 7%, obviously, of new listings came in. Right? And what we then did is we looked at how, depending on how many reviews a listing had collected over time, how the average rating changed. And this is shown here in this animated graph, which animates these 19 months over time. And as you can see, on the most left side, that is for really few ratings, pretty much every rating score is still present and existing. And over time, as listings collect more ratings, the picture thins out and only the ones with high evaluations remain in the market. right? So you have this up or out dynamic, basically. You either have a high rating from the start and remain or retain it, or if you're doing poorly in the beginning, you either get better quickly or you drop out of the market, right? It's this up or out dynamic, basically. And looking at the churn rates for these different evaluations, these rating scores, we actually see that they're markedly higher for lower ratings. So this was some first confirmation of this market dynamics hypothesis, where churn is actually one factor that contributes to this market skewness of reputation. Another factor we looked at, so let me first distinguish between the four categories we found here. We found that, or we proposed that there are four different categories: one, transaction-based reputation, including these rating scores and also text reviews, where the parties rate each other. The second are expressive user profiles, where the users are able to just upload photos or descriptions of themselves. And then there's identity verification, where you either upload a copy of your passport or you verify your email address or your phone number through the platform, which is then indicated on the platform. Or last, there's implicit information, which emerges by you as a user on the platform acting and conducting transactions. And this also includes stuff like information on how long you have been on the platform and how many transactions you have gained and how many ratings you have given, for instance. So the second category I want to illustrate here is the one with expressive user profiles, which also play a huge role for creating trust, in particular the role of profile images. And as you can see, pretty much all but I think one platform provides the possibility to upload pictures, and a large fraction of users actually does so. Not all of them provide a picture where their face is visible, but you can see that large fractions of users actually do that. And why is this a viable trust queue? Well, faces create trust. Some of the ride-sharing, of the former ride-sharing companies, actually used this claim for themselves in order to prompt users to upload photos, because faces create trust. On a former version of BlaBlaCar, you were even able to filter your search results by a small filter, where you could only show those pictures that have a profile images. So I guess this illustrates the importance of this specific feature. If you look at the drivers here listed here, that you may think that not for all of them the photo is actually helpful in terms of creating trust. But well, I guess this is highly subjective, of course. And you see also in other studies that looking at where people's gazes go, that faces always create a focus point, and people focus on faces. And this is particularly interesting in contrast to this e-trusted logo, which is also intended to create trust, but receives much less attention than the logo and the face here. Well, and this is actually something that is basically pre-wired and hardwired within the human brain. There's this fusiform face area, which is a specific area in the brain that is dedicated to processing facial information and interpreting facial information. And this is an automatic process, happens in milliseconds. It's not controllable by your consciousness. And it's also it's actually also present in infants. A few minutes after birth, they react to faces. And this speaks in favor of the fact that we can't but react to faces. So this may be an explanation for the power of faces in such online environments as well. And funnily enough, this is actually true for other facial features, such as comic faces and even animal faces. It's not, this area doesn't respond to other body images like hands or the back of the head. So it's selectively active for faces. And the fact that it's also responsive for cartoon faces led us to think about avatars, because based on this finding, based on this assumption, avatars should also trigger these reactions. And this is a set of avatars. Well, we didn't use this specific set, but another set in a study, and found that also avatars are highly capable of creating trust, almost similar to regular profile images. And this is particularly interesting, of course, in terms of privacy considerations, where you maybe don't want to give away all this biometric facial information, but kind of cover up a little bit. And avatars may be a really, really good alternative for doing so, so, while retaining high levels of trust. Okay, let me just check the time shortly. All right. Another aspect I want to briefly mention is the flow of reputation between platforms. Right. So let's skip that one. Looking at today's platform landscape, we observe that many users are active on many platforms, sometimes with increased multi-homing costs, of course, but there arise particular problems when you're thinking about becoming active on a new platform. And that's actually true for both hosts and guests or providers and consumers. Because getting started on a new platform, you always face this inherent cold start problem. Not having collected any ratings yet makes it harder for you to sell or even to get accepted when requesting a ride or requesting an accommodation. And the obvious idea, of course, is that if you're active or have been active on other platforms and have collected a really good reputation there, why not make use of that, right? Why not just carry it over somehow and benefit from this reputation you gain somewhere else? The problem, of course, is that most of these platforms function in silos and don't communicate with each other, and each maintains their own reputation system, and it's really hard to take this information along, right? And what we set off here with the general question whether from a user psychology perspective, not so much from a technical perspective, but from a user psychology perspective, is it actually feasible for you when transferring this reputation from one context to another? Does it actually function? Does the other market side actually appreciate that? Or is it like, okay, this reputation is from somewhere else, I don't even mind? Well, so we attempted to actually focus on users and measure the evaluations of these transfers. Right, is this reputation that is gained here also active in another context? And then this raises a lot of like strategic questions in terms of platform competition, where it may be easy to transport your eBay ratings to Airbnb because these platforms don't really compete with each other. But it may be a different picture when Vimdoo, like a competitor of Airbnb, starts to do that and starts to allow users to take their Airbnb ratings along. Right? They may claim actually to that this is proprietary information on their platform. So there may arise interesting conflicts in this regard. And well, one idea, of course, and one obvious idea is that looking at these platform silos would be to come up with some personal information management system, some new platform, some new sort of player that actually collects ratings from all of these platforms and provides them as a service to other platforms. And of course, this is not a new idea. I think Rachel Boltzmann had this online article already in 2012 talking about this general notion and also mentioning a lot of initiatives that were looking into this and actually trying to do this, like Trust Cloud, Trust Rank, Connect Me, etc. But basically, all of them have failed by now, and none of these companies that was mentioned in this 2012 article is active anymore. Today, however, we are lucky enough to have new startups that are attempting to get into this quite tricky business, obviously. Deemly, for instance, and Trady, Sarah is also here. And of course, it's a little tricky. I guess you may comment after the talk that it's notoriously tricky to do this. Yeah, and let's not forget about Reputrans, another company that's trying to do that. Well, and what the main idea, of course, is to create something like a reputation passport where you log on this Trady or Deemly service, provide some access to your platform profiles, maybe for your eBay or for your Airbnb profile, and then let the service collect your ratings from this context. And then it would be really interesting to have this like reputation set card as a reference, or even to have new platforms implemented, integrated within their design, so that users can simply log on to this system, connect to the system, and have all their old reputation available there, right? So this is, as I said, it's notoriously difficult. And another idea would be to connect these platforms on a bilateral basis, where you just say, okay, we won't even have a third-party services that service that does this collection and aggregation of reputation, but we are just allowing direct communication between platforms. So reputation import export business, basically. Yeah. And there are examples actually for that. Bonanza.com, I think it's one of the next slides. Let me just skip forward a bit. Bonanza.com is a US-based eBay alternative, and they actually allow their sellers to import reputation from eBay. So it's a bit bizarre, because if you look at the distribution of ratings on Bonanza.com, then you see that most sellers have a few ratings only, like 10 or 15 ratings on Bonanza. And also most sellers have imported reputation from eBay, like 90%, I guess, and these numbers are much higher. If they import, they import like a couple of thousands. So this is probably, we haven't really figured out what's going on there exactly, but it's probably like a secondary sales channel to power sellers of eBay. So the market dynamics and the reputation dynamics are a little odd on this platform, and we haven't really understood it fully. And one really important aspect to mention here, of course, is the EU GDPR, which in Article 20 explicitly grants users the right to data portability, right? So platforms, or as they call it, the controllers, are obliged to provide means to basically to export the data the users uploaded or provided to the platform. Right? And now, of course, the question is, does this actually apply to reputation? And there is still some legal dispute, I think, going on, but my hunch is that it really doesn't. It really doesn't apply to reputation, because this is really not information you as a user provided, but usually someone else provided for you. And even if the platform made it available for you to download it, what good would that be, right? So you download your reputation information from eBay, and then what? Having it on your own, having it available for you, and then uploading it to a different platform would run the risk of manipulation, and it would be really tricky to secure this. So I guess the way out would be a direct communication between platforms, like import functions or even bilateral import function, or even one-way import functions, as in Bonanza, for instance. And there's this interesting case, I think, in the late 90s when Amazon tried to do a similar thing and try to import reputation from eBay. And they had to cease doing this because eBay took legal steps against that. So this is actually not a really new topic, but this happened to occur earlier as well. And as mentioned, the study we conducted here was a scenario-based online experiment in which we confronted subjects with this hypothetical sharing scenario, in which they were to like buy or rent a product from a host or a driver or a seller, and on different platforms, and in this case on Airbnb, and they would see that the provider has reputation available on the platform itself. So we call this on-site reputation, because it's on the platform itself. Or there's no reputation whatsoever, as like benchmark comparison cases, or there's no reputation on the target platform, but on some other source platform. In this case, not on Airbnb, but there's reputation imported from eBay in this case, right? And we looked at all combinations of platforms in this regard, and what you see here is that this import actually works. We observe increased levels of trust and also of purchase intentions in turn, and you see that the gray bars represent these import conditions. The white bar is the condition without any reputation at all, and you see that the gray bars are substantially higher in most cases, but you also see that they don't really reach the on-site scenario, where on-site reputation is still the most effective one. And what we also see is that this is highly dependent on the fit between platforms. So whether source and target platform have a high fit, right? it may not be good to import reputation from eBay to Airbnb, right? Because consumers may not even see a good fit there. But between Uber and BlaBlaCar, this fit level may be higher. And this is indicated in the middle of this diagram here. You see that fit actually is a strong driver of trust in the target platform then. So if you think about importing bilaterally between platforms, make sure that the platforms actually have something in common. So that maybe some set of skills is similar, or that the reputation also makes sense in the target context. So what's next? Well, I just thought about a few topics that I thought were interesting and maybe hopefully even for some of you guys. And I think that should be addressed by the larger sharing economy or the platform economy community in the next couple of years. And the first I came up with is that my hunch is that what we need is a lot of more meta research and summaries and reviews and repositories. Because I think Renzo showed this chart yesterday where you saw the number of publications in the sharing economy related field, and it's just exploding, and it's getting more diverse, and it's getting larger, and it's getting less structured. And I think there's a need to clean up a little bit and to provide some sort of structure and repositories. A PhD student of mine actually did this for the case of Airbnb. We just simply typed in Airbnb into Google Scholar and dug through all the results, and we came up with a quite substantial list. This was published, this year or late last year, and this is only the first version. And we kind of extended it, and I think it doubled in size. And it's available on my institute's platform website. So feel free to take a look, like a structured repository of papers where you'll find pretty much anything related to Airbnb. It may even, you may be aware of these repositories that were set up by Rachel. I think Martin also runs some sort of repository. It may be even something that can be done within the IWSE community. This may be maybe even an option to set up repositories or this review projects within the scope of this community. So this is definitely something to think about. The second aspect, or the second idea I want to pitch is, well, we've been talking a lot about rating systems, reputation systems, and we see that there's this one type of rating systems that is really reliable, objective, and usually based on numerical evaluations, for instance, star ratings, right? And then there's this other sort of information that is also really effective, which is expressed in these user profiles, right? A profile image or some personal description about your occupation, about your hobby on the platform. And both these aspects have advantages, right? The one is objective and really reliable. The other isn't that reliable, but it's personal. But there's something actually in the middle here, and this is text reviews that are provided by the third party, so they can be assumed to be quite reliable, and they also pertain personal information, right? So this is text reviews as a means of creating trust may have a really special role here, and this is particularly interesting as text reviews haven't really been studied that much in comparison to reputation systems and star ratings and other stuff. So I think this may even be a research gap to get into text reviews if you're interested in how these function to build trust, whether for instance one bad review spoils a whole sea of good reviews. There are some really interesting questions emerging, I guess. Connected to this, of course, is the topic of fake reviews, which has long been a large topic for platforms like Amazon or TripAdvisor or Yelp, these open platforms where pretty much everyone can write reviews about products or restaurants or stays. But I think this is something we haven't really observed for these closed sharing economy platforms. So fake reviews may be actually something to look at for instance on Airbnb and other platforms. And what you see there is that this whole secondary industry is emerging for fake reviews. You can actually buy Twitter followers, you can buy App Store ratings, And there are companies like Five Star Marketing, which kind of openly offer this. And if you look at the prices here, it's quite a substantial market where you pay like 20 euros for one review. And this, of course, is available for Google and for pretty much every service. So there's this whole like a little bit shady secondary industry, and then there is another secondary counter industry, with, for instance, ReviewMeter, where you can put in an Amazon site, an Amazon product site, and it will filter out based on like fancy AI technology. They say it will filter out the fake reviews and come up with a real score, like not 4.2 in this case, but like leveraged down to 2.1, which is supposed to be the right score for this product. And of course, the last thing I'd like to pitch is that we've been talking about two-sided markets a lot, and most platform models we observe are two-sided markets. But this is definitely not the end, and there are even more complex models. Three-sided platforms like Foodora or these delivery services, where you have the drivers, the customers, and the restaurants, and have to manage and balance basically all these three sides, all these three players. And this is, of course, an additional layer of complexity, but there hasn't been any research as far as I know in this regard. So this may be an actual research lacuna to go into and to get further a little bit. All right, in the interest of time, I think I'll conclude it here. Thank you very much, and I'm looking forward to questions.